and Harper Audio present April, May, June, July, a novel by Alison B. Hart. Performed by Kristen Sieh. For my family, wherever we go. April 2014. 1. April. April looked through the glass walls of the third-floor conference room where her colleagues had been camped out all week, negotiating deal terms, and tried and failed to refrain from picturing opposing counsel naked. She hadn't been this horny on a daily basis since she was 16, and Bobby Coffey's heavy-lidded stares during pre-calc foretold another lunchtime rendezvous in the park across from Taco Bell, his tongue urgent and slick with enchilada sauce, his hands daring to go ever farther under her clothes as her breath caught in her throat. She'd nearly gotten a C in math that semester, until her teacher's call home prompted a stinging lecture from Nancy about college and the importance of maintaining her GPA and using her goddamn brain. Her teenaged brain, while miraculous and expansive, could not compartmentalize as neatly as her 36-year-old brain could, and so she'd had to give Bobby up before they went all the way. Now that she was a responsible adult, though, a partner at Sullivan, Hawthorne, and Pollard, and a married mother of two, she knew how to walk and chew gum at the same time. She could do her job at the Baltimore law firm where she'd worked her whole career, and she could navigate the unexpected pulses of heat and want that shot through her at the sight of her ex-lover just a few feet away. The past 2 weeks with him so close by had tested her focus, but she wouldn't let him derail her. She went down the hall to her office to get some distance. On the corner of her desk was a square envelope that she'd brought from home this morning. It was cream-colored, with hand lettering, and April knew without checking the return address what it was. The invitation to her little sister's wedding. The engagement dinner was tonight in Philadelphia. She steeled herself, then slid her fingertip along the envelope's seam and tugged out the card. Ahmed and Maryam Mansour request the honor of your presence at the marriage of their daughter Hannah and Juniper, daughter of Francis and Nancy Barber, Saturday, June 14th, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Prospect House, Princeton University. Reception to follow. Juniper. So she was sticking with it then, the name. A juniper was a tree or a berry, not a sister. An affectation she'd picked up at college, the way April had picked up clove cigarettes. She was June on her birth certificate. Junie to her family, third in a line of four barber siblings whose names tripped off the tongue like a song. April, May, June, July. But it was their father's name on the next line that made April's heart capsize. The lovely, proper Christian name that called to mind a knobby-kneed British schoolboy in short pants and tall socks. Not the stocky kid on the Chesapeake Bay. The curly swoosh capping the F like the beret on a papal Swiss guard. So much pomp and circumstance, hoping and failing to obscure one man's absence. He'd been gone nearly 10 years, but no one had ever called their father Francis. He'd only ever been Frank, at work, at home, and with his friends, in the headlines. Every time the barbers gathered without Frank felt wrong. Each Christmas or birthday somehow off-key and out of tempo, until they'd just stopped insisting on them, letting holidays pass unremarked upon, or finding new constellations of people to celebrate with. But a wedding? How? Maybe if Frank were dead, they could have found a way to honor him through it. Holding a thought for lost loved ones during the ceremony, maybe, or dancing to his favorite song at the reception. Or if he'd abandoned them all, they could have forgotten him, cut him out of their rituals without guilt or fear. But he wasn't dead, or a deadbeat. He was just gone, missing, leaving a hole in their lives. And the anniversary of his disappearance was the week after the wedding. Like it or not, the ceremony was barreling toward them. She'd have to get new dress shoes for her son, April thought, shoving her messy grief in the junk drawer, turning to the safety and momentum of a to-do list. And pants that were long enough. A new dress for her daughter. April recalled the struggle to outfit her siblings for her own wedding 14 years ago. May, a legitimately terrible maid of honor, who'd shown up late and with no speech prepared, wearing Doc Martens under her dress. Junie, the awkward flower girl who hated the ruffly gunny sacks dress their mom had picked out for her. July, fidgety in his first suit. April had gotten married so young, the summer before her last year of law school. Ross, the newest associate at Thurman Architects. At 24, she'd become a mother. It had all felt like progress at the time, but now she saw how much she'd rushed through. The liminal spaces where anything and everything was possible. Soon after giving birth, she became regretfully aware of all the other things in life she could not now do. Skydiving, vows of silence, hiking the Appalachian Trail or weeks-long business trips to Hong Kong or Mumbai. Sure, kids were portable, but there were limits. The second time she got pregnant, she was experienced enough to know that there was no way to prepare for the chaos. It didn't matter if you had a summer baby or a winter baby, if you breastfed or not, if the older one potty trained early or late. There was a long, dark tunnel, and you were going in it. You might have marginally more confidence, but even so, inside the tunnel, mistakes would be made. The beautiful plan you'd dreamed up in your head was going to be torn to shreds. If you were lucky, you'd all come out the other end mostly happy and alive. If you were lucky. And April hadn't felt lucky in a long time. Oh, enough already, she chided herself. Self-pity didn't pay the bills. She turned her attention to the mounds of paper on her desk, the never-ending work that was expected of her. She had an hour before she had to leave for the engagement party. Right on cue, April's cell phone lit up. It was Maddie, her oldest, whose magical powers for detecting when her mother needed to concentrate were as sharp at age 12 as they'd been as a baby. "What's up, pup?" April asked, thumbing through the settlement terms for another acquisition.
I can't believe you're not coming to see my play. I mean, I'm only in sixth grade once.
Nice try. April was used to deflecting her preteen's guilt trips, as if she wielded Wonder Woman's bracelets. But today, she felt all too mortal. She was sorry to miss Maddie's concert tonight, but there would be others, and one engagement dinner for Junie.
Daddy and Coop will be front row center, and I'll come to the next one.
But everyone else's mom will be there.
Hey. April heard Ross bark from across the room. Then suddenly he was on the line instead. She was just supposed to call to say hi. Don't worry about her. In 10 minutes, she'll be relieved you're not coming and mortified that I am.
I know.
Her daughter's adolescence and everything that came with it. Moodiness, hormones, hair in new places, and breasts she alternately wanted to smother under a sweatshirt or show off in her sports bra, crushes that were written all over her face, alongside the murderous looks she'd give you if you had the temerity to ask about them. It was the weather their household lived under. And it didn't matter how devoted and present a father Ross was, April was still the mother. She was the parent Maddie raged against in her quest for individuation. The brain science talk the guidance counselors had given the parents at the start of the year was no help. Like holding up a shitty little $5 umbrella in the storm of feelings that were roiling in middle school. The conversation with her daughter about how the girl's body and mind were changing was oceanic and ongoing, and 9 times out of 10, April had to badger Maddie into having it. Maybe she wasn't quite the mother she'd thought she would be, patient and endlessly available. But she had so many other roles. Loving wife, dutiful daughter, big sister, the youngest woman to make partner at the firm, number 2 in billable hours. And now she had this engagement dinner looming, where she'd need to be chatty and effervescent when she felt anything but.
"Just go and have fun tonight," Ross said,
as Craig popped his head in April's office, one eyebrow raised in that way of his that only ever meant one thing.
"Tell Junie I said hi."
"You know it's still cheating, even if we do it in a car,"
Craig said, when she should have been sitting down with her family in Philly but was sitting on him instead. We don't get bonus points for not using a bed. Shut up, she said, her head ramming into the roof of his BMW in the parking lot behind the Walgreens. She sank into him with her hips and closed her eyes, unwilling to lose hold of this thread she'd caught, leading into the sweet, aching center of herself. She came extravagantly. In the stillness that followed was that grateful moment, all too brief, in which she forgot everything and everyone, even herself. The push-pull of their fucking was the engine of her desire. April craved this stolen pleasure, the only thing that cut through the noise of her life, and she loathed herself for chasing it again so soon. She had to stop this. She'd known it the first time she tried to end things with Craig. 2 months ago, she'd broken it off because it was wrong and greedy, because her husband was a good man and didn't deserve to have only pieces of her, because her firm did too much business with Craig's flagship client, and it was only a matter of time before they had a direct conflict of interest. Now here she was again, her promises to herself broken, and that big speech about how he couldn't expect her to just drop everything whenever he called, though if she were honest, it was her doing most of the calling, and if he really wanted to turn her on, then he'd let her go, delete her number, focus on his own marriage, and let her live her life, all for nothing. She had to do something. She had to rewrite the pathways in her mind, the ones that sent her again and again racing away from her responsibilities into her lover's arms. She'd never imagined when she was the one sending out wedding invitations that one day she'd find herself here, lying to her family, breaking her vows. But after she'd crossed the line once, it was so simple to step over it again. She couldn't lie to herself anymore. Quitting Craig cold turkey hadn't worked. He was just too easy to find. True change wouldn't take root without reinforcements. She needed to get far, far away. An ocean and a plane ride away. She needed to escape the escape. The next morning, she called her mom. She chalked up the missed engagement dinner to a work emergency and bemoaned the way her hectic life interfered with her priorities. Then she said, "Let's take a trip. Just you and me." 2. May.
"Go ahead,"
Keith radioed back to May. Her supervisor had served as a medic in Afghanistan before heading up the large mammals section of the Chesapeake Zoo, and he still brought an army captain's zeal to comms. May pictured him at the drive-thru ordering, "Large fries, over." Or on the phone with his doctor's office, spelling out his name, "Kilo Echo India Tango Hotel." "Scout's hurt," May said over the airwaves. "His right front foot." The elephant calf was limping. Her best guess, he'd developed a crack in his toenail or the sole of his foot. Common enough among animals in captivity, though no signs had been present when they'd examined him 3 days ago. To be certain, the keepers would need to take him inside the elephant barn and get him to raise his foot for inspection, and that meant separating him briefly from his mother, against whom he was leaning for support.
"Roger that."
"I'll grab Randy and Kristen, and we can get started on the footwork." May waited a bit, hated herself, and then added, "Over."
"Negative. Do not examine him without me present. I repeat, do not examine the elephant without me. Do you copy?"
"Yeah, I got it."
"What's your 20?
"I'm at the puzzle feeders." The puzzle feeders were holes in the enclosure wall into which she'd stuffed alfalfa, sweet potatoes, and zucchini. She'd accessed the feeders by climbing a ladder, and from there, she had a clear line of sight into the enclosure.
"Roger, rendezvous at the barn in 15 minutes. Out."
May put the radio away. Prick. Last month, Keith had caught her rubbing a lion's mane during enrichment time, a violation of protected contact regulations. So she'd been moved off large cats, where she'd spent the bulk of the last 3 years, over to elephants. The reassignment should have been punishment enough, both for her and for the cats, who probably didn't understand why they no longer saw her every day. But she was still on Keith's shit list, For weeks, May had been working at a painfully respectful distance from the giant beasts, refilling the feeders, dragging browse into the enclosure while the elephants were in the barn, acting as the third set of hands during footwork. But mostly, she'd been falling in love. On trips to the zoo as a child, she'd whisked past Sabrina, the matriarch, sparing a few quick gawks and then dashing off to see the monkeys.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.